Good morning students. Today we are going to see the continuation of 8051 addressing mode. Today we are going to see register indirect addressing mode. In register indirect addressing mode, we are not going to mention the address directly in the instruction. Instead, we are going to mention the register that holds the actual address. So when you use a register indirect addressing mode, you are going to use only R0, R1 and data pointer. Apart from this, none other registers like R2, R3, R4, like that if you are using, it will become an invalid instruction. So both R0 and R1 hold a 8-bit address, whereas the data pointer will hold a 16-bit address. You can see the first instruction, move A, @R0. So inside this, suppose if R0 is representing the address, you consider before this I am giving move R0, #55. So the value of R0 is 55. At R0 means in that 55th location, what data is available that will be moved on to your accumulator. That is, what is the content available inside that R0 that will be moved on to your accumulator. Same thing when you consider add A, @R1, it means that before this I'm using move R1, #45H. It means 45 is stored in R1. So in that 45th location, at means at what is the value representing at this particular location, what data is available that will be added with the accumulator, and the result of addition will be saved in the accumulator. Move X, it is nothing but external memory access. So data pointer will hold a 16-bit address indirect. So if it is a indirect addressing mode, you have to specify R0, R1 and data pointer register. These three registers should be followed with the @ symbol. In case of immediate addressing mode, data is followed by # symbol, whereas here in case of your register indirect addressing mode, your register that is holding the address will be followed with the @ symbol. It is your register indirect addressing mode. Apart from R0, R1 and data pointer, if you give R3, R4 like that, then the instruction is going to be invalid. Next is your indexed addressing mode. So this indexed addressing mode, in this indexed addressing mode, either the program counter or the data pointer is used to hold the base address. Here we will be having a base address. Either the program counter or the data pointer will hold this address, and the accumulator is used to hold the offset address. Adding these two values, you will get, adding your base address to the value of the offset address forms the effective address. There are three addresses you have. One is your offset address, second one is your base address, and third one is your effective address. Your program counter and data pointer will hold the base address. Accumulator will hold your offset address. When you add your offset address with the base address, you will get a effective address. So inside this effective address, what is the content available that will be moved on to your accumulator. So it means that copies the content of the memory location pointed out by your accumulator and the data pointer is moved on to your accumulator. It is index addressing mode. Next one is your relative addressing mode. In relative addressing mode is used with the conditional jump instruction. So here you can see SJMP, it is nothing but short jump. So directly here I'll be specifying loop one. So this loop one will have a certain address in the instruction. So automatically when the controller executes this particular line, it automatically goes on to this particular label. Here the relative address is a 8-bit signed number. The jump designation is usually specified using a label, and the assembler calculates the jump offset accordingly. So the advantage of using this relative addressing is the program code can be easily relocated and the address is relative to the position in the memory. This is your relative addressing. Next is your absolute addressing. The absolute addressing is used only by AJMP, that is absolute jump, and ACALL, that is absolute call. These two instructions are 2-byte instruction. So this addressing mode is very specific. that is the lower 11 bit of the memory address as a part of your instruction, and the upper, because each is 16 bit, right? So the upper 5 bit of the destination address or the upper 5 bit of the current program counting counter. What is meant by a program counter? Program counter, it is a 16 bit register that stores the address of the next instruction to be executed. Next is your long addressing. It is used with LJMP and LCALL. So LJMP, so whatever I am representing after this LJMP and LCALL, it is going to be the label. Directly the 16 bit address is labeled here. So when this particular instruction is executed, it automatically jumps towards this particular label. It is your long addressing. So in case of long addressing, the address specifies the complete 16 bit destination address, whereas in case of absolute addressing, the lowest 11 bit of the memory addresses as a part of your instruction, whereas the upper higher bit, upper 5 bit will represent the destination address or 5 bit of current program counter. Next is your bit inherent addressing. Bit inherent addressing means clear flag, that is CLR means clear carry flag. It contains only operand and it implies in the opcode of the instruction. So in this addressing, the address of the flag contains, the address of the flag will contain the operand and is implied in the opcode of the instruction. Bit addressing means we need to be specific with the clear bit, that is set B 07H. So it is nothing but that 7th bit of R7 will be 1. Likewise, you can use it with PSW also, set B PSW.3, clear PSW.4. So using these two instruction, it is possible for us to set or clear a bit of data in a particular register. Thank you, students. In the next class, I'll be dealing with some important programs dealing with all these addressing modes. Thank you all. Here I have shown one example program that represents the register addressing, immediate addressing and indirect addressing. This particular program is to move a data from, is to move a block of data from one memory location to another memory location. So looking at this, move R0 comma hash 30H. So 30H is that this data is followed. Here the data is immediately available in the instruction. So this particular line holds immediate addressing. Same thing, move R1 comma hash 40. Hash 40 means this particular line holds immediate addressing because the data is directly available in the instruction. Same thing here, move R3 comma hash 0AH. Here also 0A stands for 10 data. So that is moved onto your R3 register. The first three instruction represent immediate addressing mode. Now in this R3, this 10 data. So from one memory location to other memory location, I have to move. You consider now I am going to use, I am going to load the data in 30th location. So if I am going to load the data on 30th location, it means that inside that 30th location, whatever data is available, that will be moved on to, that will be moved on to your accumulator. I'll show the program execute. So for this particular program, we are going to load the data in 30th location. So you can see here 0x30, it is the memory location loaded with 10 data, so A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, like this. It is not mandatory that you have to give the same data, you can give any number of data, but only the 10 data will be considered, that is 0A, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, A, but B is also there, but only till here it will be considered. When it execute this instruction, move A comma at R0, it means what is the value of R0 available? 30. Inside that 30th location, so inside this 30th location, what is the data available? A1. That will be moved on to the accumulator. Now when the microcontroller execute this particular line, move at R1 comma accumulator, it means what is the content of accumulator now? The content of accumulator is A1. So that particular A1 is moved to, what is the content of, what is R1? 40. So is moved as content to R1. So when you see the, this is before execution, before executing this program, it is the status. Once the program is executed, whatever data you have given in 30th memory location, that will be moved on to the 40th location. So here we have used the indirect addressing mode. When you use a indirect addressing mode, you need to use only R0 register, R1 register and data pointer. INC stands for increment register. Increment which register? R0. So when the controller executes this line, now the content of R0 will be, that is the R0 is incremented to 31. So when R0 is incremented to 31, even it has to move on to the next location. So you need to increase this R1 content also. So you need to increment R1 register. So after executing this register, after executing this instruction, the content of the value available in R1 will be 41. Decrement R3. It means that among this 10 data, one data is already moved. So remaining 9 data has to be moved. So you need to decrement this R3 content. So R3 register, if you decrement, you will get 09. So if this particular content, if jump on non-zero, if this particular register is not zero, then it will go to back. Now what is the value available on R0? It is 31. Value available on R1 is 41. So inside this 31, that is at 31th location, it is 30th location and this is your 31st location. At 31th location, what data is available, that will be moved on to your accumulator. Now the content of accumulator will be A2. Now the content of accumulator is A2, that is moved on as a content to R1. So what is R1 available at present after incrementing 41? So at 41th location, my content of accumulator will be moved. This is how the program executes. So it is a simple logic that describes the moving a block of data from one memory location to the other memory location. In the next chapter, after reading all the instruction set, then you will be very clear with what exactly INC stands for, DEC stands for, what is the number of machine cycle it takes to execute, what this particular instruction will do. So all these things in the next chapter we'll come to know. Thank you students, just go through the videos, and our notes is also uploaded in the Google Classroom. Kindly go through the notes, and if you guys have any doubt, please ping me in the Google Classroom. Thank you students.